Volkswagen as a company entered China in the early 80s. Probably this early entrance is what allowed them to reap the benefits.
Europe is old and Africa is young, and that's why it's clear to me that the future is there.
Research about Africa has mainly been driven by two extremes. The institutions that do the big macroeconomic analysis, the World Bank, the IMF, you have also a lot of research in everything that is related to social entrepreneurship, the NGO type of research. But there is a gap in the middle.
Because it's so different from what we are used to in the West.
This level at which you want to define how really business operates there.
The sooner you go, the better off you will be.
And this is what our research here at IESE tries to fill.
I decided to go and spend a substantial amount of time in Africa when I heard a professor from Lagos Business School talking about both his school and his country. I saw the entrepreneurial drive there. People saying, yes, things can happen and we are going to make them happen.
A good friend of mine that is an entrepreneur, he finds it very well. He says that for once in his life, he thought he was like on top of the wave and not behind it, no? I arrived, as I said, into Kenya in 2007, and the road that leads from the airport to the city center, Mombasa Road, at that time was, I would say, a pretty empty road. I mean, you could see a lot of nature around. If you go now, this is probably a very busy, busy road, no? With a lot of, I will say, factories, dealerships, distribution, warehouses, no?
Yeah, and that's why you have to be there, because the macro indicators signal towards that growth, but you really need to be there to understand what's going on.
Let's start by this key point. Of course, assume now is the time to invest, and actually you have to really know what is happening in the ground. Let's start by a key fact. There is not such a thing as Africa. Africa is very diverse. You have 50 countries that can be considered 50 Africas.
Yes, and if you think about the various regions in which African countries are grouped, you also find that diversity. Within regions, there are also important differences. So you cannot use a copy-paste approach. The strategy that works in one country may not work in another country. And even Africans themselves at times make mistakes. The managing director of a bank in Kenya told me how they entered Uganda, thinking, you know, it's just 1 hour flight, so there could be not much differences. They realized that, well, regulation was very different. Ugandans take anything that comes from Kenya as imposed on them. So even if they had local people that had the right connections to the right people, that backfired because those local managers saw the Kenyans as coming and taking over them. If this happens to Africans, imagine to people who come from outside Africa.
Actually we wrote a case also about a very similar example, no? And probably most people that are familiar with Africa and with telcos or mobile payments will know about M-Pesa, because this has been the huge success in the world on mobile payments, no? Imagine in a country of 40 million like Kenya, M-Pesa has a penetration of close to 14 million, which is a lot. Okay, with a situation like that, the company, Safaricom in this case, thought exactly the same. Moving to Tanzania will be a piece of cake. Similar country by size, by population, even you share some common ethnical traits. The reality is that adoption there was very, very slow. And as you say, no, probably the first important point that played a role was cultural differences. This idea that Tanzanians perceive Kenyans as taking over, again, the same. Issues like regulation, and even things like access to key resources like distributors that make it very, very, very difficult.
And we're focusing on East Africa, but the same happens in West Africa. The founder of a company in Nigeria told me how they entered Ghana, which is next door. They thought, well, we are very similar culturally speaking, and they sent their best performing manager to run the operations in Ghana. What happened was that he was perceived as too pushy, too aggressive by the customers. If a customer would tell him, I will call you in a week, he didn't wait for the customer to call, and 2 days down the road, he was already calling them, and the customer was, okay, I told you I would call you, why are you pushing me? He himself realized that that approach didn't work, so they removed him and hired a local person, and operations just took off.
One country needs one approach. So probably the question, very relevant for managers, is then which countries should I enter, no? And how should I base my decision? And again, my sensation here is that you can base your decision in hard facts, no? You can look at things as GDP, economic growth. Probably among these indicators, for me, the two most important will be probably the degree of diversification of the economy. It's not the same to enter a country that is only resource-rich like Gabon, where probably industrial companies will have success, but consumer good companies will have not. And the other aspect is the size of the middle class, no? I mean, you have East Africa, Ghana, Nigeria, of course, South Africa, where the middle class is already developed. And this is probably very important for consumer good companies, no? But my sensation is that probably that's not enough, no?
It's not enough, among other things, because the official statistics and the hard facts hide the reality of informal economy, which is at times even up to 80% of economic activity in some countries. So you need to understand what are the drivers of your business and look for alternative, soft if you want, indicators. The founder of a Nigerian company operating in a business related to financial services, which is driven by wealth and affluence, told me that he goes to a new country before starting operations there, and one thing that he looks for is, do people use a toothpick and have a toothpick in their mouth? The reason being that in previous times there was part of the population who could not afford to eat meat on a daily basis. So they used toothpick to show we have eaten meat, we are well off.
It's curious that you mentioned the informal sector, no? Because probably what is important for business managers in the Western world to understand is that the informal sector there is much more formal than it seems, no? And I will put an example. We found this local entrepreneur, Paul Kinotia, that started basically selling soap sachets in the street. This guy gradually grew in the informal sector up to a point that he created almost like a 40 million euro company that he sold to L'Oreal. I think this leads us to another important point, no? That, as you mentioned, because of this informal sector, probably you have to take a very grassroots approach to everything you do.
Indeed, you need to go there, understand what the reality is like, identify which parts are most relevant to your business, and really gain a good in-depth knowledge there.
Okay, but then this gets me to another point. Can you do that on your own?
No, definitely no. You need to rely on local partners because the realities are so different that there are certain things that you cannot even think about them. They will never occur to you if you are an outsider.
I have a good example in that case. No? I have a company, a consumer good company, that sells basically soup bouillons. They have been quite successful. They have been in Africa for almost 30 years now, and they have a sizable market share. What actually the manager of the company told me is that even for something as simple as that, you need to customize the flavors almost to every specific country. No?
And if that happens with a product as simple as a soup cube, imagine when you get more complex products. Real estate is booming in some countries, like for instance Nigeria, so it's very tempting to enter there. However, someone was telling me how when they designed the financial products to help funding the acquisition of a house, they know that the extended family is going to collect money and put it together to help the person buying the house repay in advance. If you know that, you may offer lower interest rates. How could you know this if you are an outsider?
But I think there is another side why partners are important, the access to local resources. And you may say, well, that's generally in all emerging economies, no? And probably that's true, but in Africa it's even more important because wealth is really concentrated and resources are really concentrated, no? So things like access to land resources, to even finance, to the key people that are decision makers in companies, it's very important, no? And I remember a manager, no, telling me that the best thing that I did in the first year of my work in Africa was spending the first 2 months actually going to all the local institution meetings, professional associations, to actually know who was who.
And this is very important because those associations can help you not only know who is connected to whom, but also who is reliable, who is trustworthy.
This leads us probably, or at least to my understanding, to the next relevant thing, no? That is partnerships linked to the importance of communities. And I have a very personal view on that, no? If you think in any society, there are four fundamental institutions: the family, basically your extended community, call that your neighborhood, your tribe, okay? Then companies and nations. In the Western world, because of two facts, industrialization and nationalism, communities as such has lost power. So people have the family, the company, or the nations. Curiously for me in Africa, because none of these things happened very strongly, there was not a strong industrialization, and actually nations somehow are risen and imposed, really, the institution that still is very important, apart from the family, is the extended community. That is very important for business because it has two sides, no? It has positive aspects and negative aspects.
Yes, and that has to do with the fact that the boundaries between what the family and the community is and what the company is are blurred. Several people from Kenya told me how when they went to Tanzania, something that really surprised them was that it wasn't uncommon that someone would take money out of the company. And when they told them, well, you cannot do that, the Tanzanians were surprised, like, well, don't worry, I will just give it back, no big deal.
Well, I mean, as you started with the negative things, no? Yeah, I have another interesting example there, no? And it's the manager of a pharmaceutical company telling me, well, when I arrived there, it turned out that all my commercial department were people from the same tribe. That was a problem. At first, because they had basically a very narrow approach to the customers, no? To customers that actually were from the same tribe. And the second thing is that he told me, and of course, there was a lot of, let's say, petty corruption around it, because of the fact that they all belong to the same tribe. No, so he kind of personally gave me the advice. I mean, if you run a company like that, make sure that in every department you have people from different communities.
However, the focus on communities also has positive aspects to it. Once I heard someone saying, you in the West say, I am because I think. In the East, they say, I am because I become. Here in Africa, we say, I am because you are. And I think that reflects very well the African mentality, that the community has to be an integral part of your strategy.
And I have a similar sensation, no? That sometimes in the Western world, we have lost a little bit the sense of what business do, no? And if we truly believe that the importance is to have an impact on society. Probably, if there is a place now where you can see that, it's in Africa, no? And the type of capitalism that we have there, it's one in which the positive implications for society are very, very strong, no?
Indeed. In fact, at times they talk about Africapitalism in the sense that it's a capitalist system, but that takes into account the interests of all the stakeholders, not only those of the shareholders. Talking to the CEO of a bank in Kenya, I asked him, what keeps you awake at night? He told me, are we doing enough for our society? Are we doing enough to help improving the living conditions of our children?
I would like to finish with a very well-known quote of probably one very famous African leader, no? That is Mo Ibrahim, the founder of Celtel. And he said something on the lines of, big business opportunities appears where the perception is much worse than the reality. In Africa, this is true. Reality is there and is much better than we perceive it.